Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. I'm Susan Stinson. I'm the writer in residence at Forbes Library, which is a fabulous, lucky thing to get to do. And this is the Local History, Local Novelist series. And the series is based on the premise that the depth and nuance and empathy with which we engage with history is in large part defined by the depth and nuance and empathy with which we engage with story, stories of all kinds. And upcoming events in this series, which is run for 4 years from fall to spring, are on Wednesday, April 9th at 7 p.m., a program called Emily Dickinson Quiet. And we've invited Jane Wald, the director of the Emily Dickinson Museum, and Kevin Quashy, who teaches at Smith and has written a wonderful adventurous book called The Sovereignty of Quiet, Beyond Resistance in Black Culture. And the Boston-based poet Charles Coe, whose most recent book is All Sins Forgiven, Poems for My Parents. I think that's gonna be fabulous, and I might have handed you a flyer for it, or there's also copies on the case over there. And then the final event of this season of Local History, Local Novelists is on Wednesday, May 7th, and it's a celebration of local novelists with Deborah Noyes, who's a novelist, and she'll be reading from her book, Captivity. Jacqueline Sheehan, who's reading from Pictured This, and Hilary Sloyne, who's reading from her novel, Art on Fire. Tonight, though, is about the Quabbin Reservoir. And this event, as many of you know, because we talked about this as some people arrived, so I know some of you are very aware of it. It was originally scheduled for last month, but it was moved to tonight because of, guess what, a storm. And I'm so tired of winter. Maybe I'm not alone in that. And unfortunately, the novelist Marianne O'Hara, who was originally planning to join us, is not able to come at this date, so she won't be here tonight. But we're very lucky to have poet Gail Thomas and local historian J.R. Greene, both of whom have written books centered on the story of the Quabbin. And my great-grandmother, Lewis, the story goes, refused to leave when the state wanted to take her land for a reservoir. She sat on her front porch until she was physically carried away, rocking chair and all. That was in Oklahoma, I believe, but the idea of good land, of people's homes, and of whole towns being flooded on purpose is one that is haunting to a lot of us. The wonderful fiction writer Jhumpa Lahiri writes, "In college, I used to underline sentences that struck me, that made me look up from the page. They were not necessarily the same sentences the professors pointed out, which would turn up for further explication on an exam. I noted them for their clarity, handful of words artfully arranged, their beauty, their rhythm, and enchantment. For surely it is a magical thing for a handful of words artfully arranged to stop time, to conjure a place, a person, a situation in all its specificity and dimensions, to affect us and alter us as profoundly as real people and things do. So I want to honor all those who stopped time by writing about the lost towns of the Swift River Valley and to welcome our readers." For Gail Thomas of Northampton has published two books of poetry, No Simple Wilderness, An Elegy for the Swift River Valley, and Finding the Bear. Her poems have appeared in more than 30 literary journals and anthology, including the Beloit Poetry Journal, Calyx, Hanging Loose, the North American Review, and the Naugatuck River Review. She's won national prizes for poems that appear in her new book, Waving Back, which will be published by Word Text Turning Point Imprint next spring. That's so exciting. Thomas is the recipient of writing and teaching grants from the Massachusetts Cultural Council and the Ludwig Vogelstein Foundation, and was awarded residencies at the McDowell Colony in New Hampshire and New Cross in Wyoming. She's a learning specialist and teaches at Smith College. Welcome, Gail.
Thank you, Susan. Thank you for inviting me. And thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight and chasing away the winter blues. I'm just curious, how many people here have walked at the Quabbin? Okay, wow, lots of people. Is there anyone here who's never been to the Quabbin Reservoir? Okay, one person. Is there anyone who has gone to the Quabbin but only to the visitor center? Okay, great. So you all are kindred spirits then. I want to just begin by saying what my connection is with the Quabbin. I moved to this valley in 1981, and I lived in Shutesbury at the edge of the Quabbin and raised my two daughters there. And the first time I went to the Quabbin and walked at the Quabbin, I was just immediately struck by the palpable feel of other lives that had walked the same paths and looked at the same, not the same views, but obviously looked at the tops of the mountains. And I didn't know much of the history at that point. So in my first book, there is one poem that is about the Quabbin. And my daughter, actually, the cover picture of the first book was taken at the Quabbin. So I had no idea at that point that I would embark in this project, which was I was awarded the residency at McDowell to do this book about the Quabbin. And I was a teacher at the time, a public school teacher, and I started bringing some of the elders that are like to call themselves survivors and have meetings regularly to the school so that the teenagers could sit down and talk about their experiences, and people brought scrapbooks, and it was just such a revelation to the students. And when my book came out, I had a reading in Boston, and I was really shocked that even at this time, many people came up to me afterwards at that bookstore and said they had absolutely no idea where their drinking water came from. So that was amazing to me. And then I started really working a lot in the towns around the Quabbin, in New Salem and Petersham and Athol and Orange and Wendell. And I was working with elders doing writing workshops with those groups of people, and the stories just kept coming and coming. And so I felt that I really wanted to tell the stories and include the voices of people. So my book is structured in this way that I kind of envision the poems to be, they're sort of long, kind of thin poems, and I kind of envision them as islands. As you look out at the Quabbin, you're quite struck by that. And then throughout the book, I have the voices of people. The names have been changed, but people that I've met and spent time with who shared some of their stories, the Quabbin as well. So I use a quote by the wonderful writer John Haynes, who writes a lot about wilderness, particularly Alaska wilderness, to begin the book. And I just wanted to share with you John Haynes' quote. "Stand still where you are, at the end of pavement, in a sunbreak of the forest, on the open, cloud-peopled terrace of the plains. Look deeply into the wind furrows of the grass, into the leaf-stilled water of pools. Think back through the silence of the life that was and is not here now, of the strong pastness of things, shadows of the end and the beginning." Hiker. "For solitude, walk here. If you are patient, you will be rewarded by fox, turkey, coyote, deer. Grouse may startle up from brush, raccoon or porcupine peer down from a limb. Near water, follow osprey scanning for fish, eagles riding the thermals, loons reappearing after long dives. Trails lead past lush beds of fern, flickering in every shade of green, to dams knit by beavers, exquisite in their knowledge of where a meadow is needed. You may never see another human all day. If you listen to wind comb the forest, trees creaking like floorboards, you may suddenly be gripped by old sorrows and not know why. The names. Find an old map. Dana, Enfield, Prescott, Greenwich. Look harder for the villages. Storesville, Millington, Doubleday Village, Cooleyville, Nichewag, Atkinson Hollow, Packardville, Smith Village, Bobbin Hollow, Puppyville, North Dana. The train named Rabbit Run stopped everywhere as it looped past orchards, grain mills, harness shops, cider mills, barns, grist mills, charcoal kiln, soapstone quarry, textile mills, factories that made bonnets, bobbins, boxer, and billiard tables. Dance halls, hotels, racetrack, churches, fire departments, camps, town halls, garages, post offices, stores, schools, and cemeteries. Years of rumors, hard times, reduced the population, but no one believed complete absence would ring so loudly when the names were spoken. Harry Spencer. It hit my folks and my grandparents the hardest. We young people, why, we couldn't wait to get out of this valley. We saw it as progress. Roads. Blacktop cracked and buckled, dirt footpath, overgrown wagon route, narrow deer trails all lead down to what looks like just a slice of water glinting before the silver arc opens. To imagine where the roads continue is to listen to voices that sting like black flies with words like regret and promise. Here, loss is concealed by acres of shimmer, a magician's silk waved at the end of his best trick. Calvin Webster. Everyone knew about the plan years before the state made it official. It hung like a pall over all our talk. The state was buying, so why bother painting your house? Who sold out this week? Only a few houses were moved if someone had the money. Lake trout. Trophy size, this fish is called a success. Feeding on smelt, breeding in sandy shallows, self-sustaining. At first, soil from the plain clogged the bottom, roots and leaves grabbed for oxygen. Now rubble and stone, free of life, the deep, cold water offers its breath. Diving down to the silent center, lake trout glide over the grave of Greenwich with open eyes. Earl Gardner. All the local people laughed at the woodpeckers. They were the men from South Boston who came out to the country. They didn't know the first thing about cutting down a tree. Laborers. The first call went out and lasted for 11 years. Hard labor for men willing to drill and blast through bedrock, to work underground in rubber suits, to load muck onto switch cars, water leaking from rock seams, coating eyes and mouth, thick grit, mud spewing from the wounds. After tunnels, an engineering miracle of concrete, compression chambers, pumps, reinforced steel, and underneath it all, the digging, hauling, sand, silt, mud, mimicry of beavers, becomes Windsor Dam, Goodnow Dyke. How many valley men fed their children with bulldozing, moving graves, burning trees, the smell of labor sending its message for miles on good country air? The graves. After the sales, after the closings, after the moving, before the dynamite, before the tree cutting, before the bulldozing, was the digging up of graves, the moving of stones, the bagging of remains, the sending of letters to families asking them to choose new plots. Some chose Quabbin Park, some scattered to other towns, some couldn't manage one more thing. Some bundles of dirt and bone never matched the names scratched on fieldstone. Ashes. She wanted no grave, so we gathered on a gray day in a light rain to walk to her favorite spot, a meadow perched on the shoreline with a view of everything, water, orchard, forest, mountain, sky. Someone sang, someone told a story. I planted a hemlock so small it was lost among the high weeds. Among its roots, we sprinkled the concentrated grit of her body, and under the lowest branch, my daughter laid a stone from our garden and a black plastic bear. Rebecca Norton. The day before Enfield Church was to be torn down, there was a mysterious fire. People had their ideas about how it started, but no one really knew. Only the silver communion set was saved. It's in the museum. That would be the Swift River Historical Museum, which is a fabulous place if you want to go. It's absolutely wonderful. The artifacts. The ordinary cataloged, haunted by the ghost of lips that sipped from a cider brandy bottle, still wrapped in a brown paper bag, teeth that scraped two tined forks, feet inside tiny wedding slippers, fingers that tatted human hair, folded paper fans, smoothed axe handles. Lap organ and fiddle, Civil War drum, guns, swords, saws, honey extractor, cream separator, top hat and calling cards, camera, doctor's kit, palm leaf hats, Aunt Fanny Eaton's sewing machine, Dana's fire truck, Gilman's oil paintings, the Goodnow triplets cradle, molds from Millington Brick Factory, Lily Coolidge's stuffed parrot Ned, bridal gowns from the triple wedding, padlocked mitts from Prescott Poor Farm, the Indian dugout canoe found at the bottom of Morton Pond that causes museum visitors to argue about how the gouges were made and whether it is authentic. Song of the Nipmuc. When a deer is killed, its spirit is praised in the eating. When a trout is speared, its spirit is praised in the drying. When a rock is moved to plow a field, its spirit loses its way. When a bush cannot bear fruit, its spirit weeps. When a tree is cut and burned, its spirit is wounded. When flowing water is dammed, its spirit chokes. When shelter is destroyed, its spirit is rootless. When a grave is disturbed, its spirit is dishonored. When earth is changed beyond sight, its spirit is deceived. Althea Raymond. We picked pails and pails of blueberries to sell. Once I put a note in the bottom of a quart basket to tell whoever bought them that it was me, Althea, who did the picking. I got a letter back from a Negro cook at a hotel in Boston. She told me that she had a little girl named Althea too, It made me feel like I had been somewhere. Photographs. They were taken of vacant farmhouses, numbered cards nailed to a post in the dooryard to keep track of what would be lost. And later, sites could be mistaken for what would happen soon in Europe. Bridges dynamited, brush burned, piles of rubble where villages had been. Boys who had never left this valley landed on another continent, ready for adventure. Some came back changed as only war can change a boy, to find all that was familiar gone. Some moved into new houses, tripping in the dark where a door should have been, photographs packed away until someone asked where home was. Bald eagle. A sighting is what we long for when January wind slices across the ice. Long wings spread straight as a knife, white head lowered, eyes hungry for movement. Along the shore, sweep of feathers sounds like forgiveness. What was almost lost nests here, sins redeemed in the counting. And many times when I was writing these poems, I always wanted to know why. Like, what was the draw for me personally? How was I pulled by these stories and of loss? And it really brought me back to my own story and my immigrant roots. Wild grapes, unexpected sweetness stops my walk, and I become a dog triggered by scent to find, hidden under a canopy of leaves, wild grapes on tangled vines. Hidden heavy clusters hang like amethysts on this forgotten road, dusky purple and rose globes, some black, shriveled. Tug at a yearning deep in my belly like lust that leads to terraced hillsides, that turns away from this trail to dreams of Umbria, blue sky, sun on stucco, figs drying, willow baskets spilling over with warm fruit. Imagine a table in the shade of olives, spread with bright linen, bread and cheese. I pluck un grappolo, dark juice drips a trail to the village my grandmother never remembered. The long road home, the harvest of generations who leave and never return. I spit out the nub of seed like the childhood prayer I stopped saying, fruit of thy womb, mystery to girls thirsty for Chianti mixed with soda. Altar wine became one mystery of blood unsolved, the priest's magic hidden with a flourish behind white napkins, purple stains, a road of faith I couldn't travel. Communion comes now on a trail in this wilderness, created to satisfy another thirst, a trail haunted by lost pastures, churches, range halls. I am startled by a rush of wings, then look up. A bald eagle hovers close, hunter's head and cold appraising eye, then a cry from its mate, hidden by pines, and off over the wide water, I watch them leave. So those are the poems that I wanted to read tonight from No Simple Wilderness. I wanted to close with, this is actually a very new poem, but as I wrote it, I realized it's very connected to the story in this book. So I'll end with this. Listen, what if we stopped tweeting and texting and started listening to the dead? Put your ear next to the screen where night air blows in, under the chair where dust gathers, inside a milkweed pod before it bursts and scatters. Listen for what to pick up and what to lay down, what to begin and what to end, who to follow or abandon. At first, you may not recognize their voices, stripped of pride and doubt, speaking in tongues and ringing like morning bells, because at last, they have nothing to lose. Thank you.
I want to be sure to mention that Gail's books are here and they'll be available for sale tonight, and JR's books are here too, so they'll both be selling them over at that table after the reading. J.R. Greene has written a dozen Quabbin-related books, 12, and three related to Calvin Coolidge. This is the Calvin Coolidge Museum. He is also the vice chairman of the advisory board for the Calvin Coolidge Room here at Forbes Library, and I'm very much looking forward to his talk tonight.
I usually don't follow a script or anything like that when I speak, but I usually do a narrated slide program. I've done about 500 of them over the last 38 years for historical societies and other groups. I've done at least one or two here, and I'm working on another book, which is Quabbin-related, which I'm hoping to have an opening here sometime in the fall, if I get it finished before then. I also did 7 collections of poetry before I started writing about the Quabbin, or actually at the beginning of that era, and I did do a Quabbin poem, so I'll start with that, called Quabbin Reservoir. What else? The winds didn't shift, but they blow over water after wafting the leaves and the birds for all years. The rain is the joy of the men at the works, for the herds and the plows are but thoughts in the waves. No one works or prays or even sits and talks about the news and the weather or love life and politics. Fish are all who drink this here, or those unknowing and far away who waste and want but don't seem to save. Roads go under and streams don't flow in the bed of the sand and the stumps that serve as markers, for they even pulled out the dead so those would forget. And they say some can't come here, but others can if they have the right reasons, 5 miles long, or if they want to study the nothing and write all kinds of nothing just to leave behind nothing. Still, a few of us know what's beyond the foundations and the rust in the pines and the endless water. Your home is your castle until everyone wants it. And then they just come in and take it, and his and hers and even theirs. And all the plants and soil and rocks. A life means nothing to a lot of greed, no matter that they could end up being handed the exact sort of thing that they had demanded. Okay, I will read a quote, which I use in the beginning of my first major book on the subject, Creation of Quabbin Reservoir. A man named Thomas N. Urban, who was the former mayor of Des Moines, Iowa, said, "Once we were more or less told the citizens what we were going to do and then went ahead and did it, that world has come to an end." And I think that's obviously very appropriate when you consider Quabbin Reservoir being passed in the 1920s and built in the 30s and 40s. And, you know, you get out of the valley and Boston needs the water and, you know, tough turkey, to put it more kindly than some people would. But I've written about the history in these books, a lot about the progress of the project from the beginnings of Boston's ever westward expanding water system starting in the 1840s to get to its penultimate chapter at Quabbin Reservoir. But also I've written a lot about the towns and the people who lived in them. And this is a very important story, and it's something that a lot of people in the valley are somewhat aware of. By the way, I have one of Ms. Thomas's books in my own library, the one with the Quabbin poems in it, so I enjoyed that. And a lot of people have done novels and poems and such and so forth, including my little poem there. But I want to make some points about this, because people will say, "Well, you know, there's eagles there, and we didn't have them in Massachusetts. Isn't it great? If we didn't have the Quabbin, we wouldn't have eagles." Well, I don't know. Maybe they would have put them somewhere else. But, or as author Tom Conuel aptly named it, an accidental wilderness. The Quabbin is not a state park. It's not a wildlife preserve. It is a drinking water reservoir, and the land around it is part of the watershed of same, so that you are not allowed to camp or swim or take a sailboat or do things like that there. So that's, you know, part of the whole concept is to protect the water, which South Hadley, Wilbraham, and Chicopee out in this part of the state do get some of that water, but all the rest of it goes east to mostly places within 128. I used to take little surveys when I'd go to Red Sox games back in the 80s and stuff. Where's your water come from? The best answer I got, somebody had to be from Dachester, because that's how he tacked. He's, well, when Eddie King was governor, he built this big tank under the state house on Beacon Hill, and that's where our water comes from. It's like, you know, how do you deal with people like that? How do you explain what the Quabbin is to somebody like that, you know? Their world is circumscribed by Route 128. That's it, folks, you know? But, well, I know somebody goes skiing out there in Western Mass. You know, well, all right, but that's as far as their brain goes. The story of the Quabbin Reservoir, which I've recounted in several of my books, is quite tragic. And if you have sympathy for individual human beings, now we're not talking about, we didn't deal with a valley full of Mitt Romneys or Dick Cheneys or Bushes or whatever. We're talking about mostly relatively poor working people, farmers, that sort of thing. Yeah, there were a few wealthy people mixed in, but not many. And as I like to put it, frankly, when it came time for these people to sell out, they got screwed. Most of them did. A few of them got lawyers, a few of them fought it and got a little better settlement. Some people were paid something for the loss of a business, some people weren't. The people who sold out early on in the 1930s during the depths of the Great Depression often got the least for their property because of the fact that the property values were very low everywhere. Again, this was not a kind, gentle thing. This is not the late 20th, early 21st century. These people got paid minimum amount for their property. There was no job or housing relocation assistance. Mike Dukakis wasn't there holding people's hand. You found a new place to live, you moved to it, you found a new job or bought another farm and started over again in farming. Okay, this is not the welfare state. By the way, this was not a New Deal project. This began in, the first legislation was passed in 1926 and 1927. This was done for the benefit of metropolitan Boston getting water, drinking water. So this started before the crash of 29 or anything else. They did use some New Deal money near the end, which I recount in this book, to do some of the roads around the so-called Quabbin Park at the southern end of the reservoir and a few of the structures and things. But this was funded by the so-called ratepayers, the people who drink the water that comes from there. So they had to pay the debt off to do that. Now, the people who were in the valley, yes, a few of them did work on the project. Some who sold out early were able to rent their property back at very reasonable prices if it wasn't needed for a structure or anything, at least until the mid to late 30s. And some people, you know, did okay working and things like that. But as Gail referred to the woodpeckers, this was a special project that wasn't necessary. It was done about 2-3 years before it was needed, so that Governor James Michael Curley could get a bunch of his constituents from Boston unnecessary jobs out here, make-work jobs, as they were called. And most of these people didn't know a thing about handling an axe or a hatchet or a saw or anything else, so that's why the valley people called them woodpeckers. And when it was all done, they wasted about, I don't know, $1.5 million doing this, and most of the guys didn't bother to pay for bus fare to go to Boston to vote for Curley in his run for U.S. Senate, so he lost. So, well, maybe that's fitting. But in any event, they had to hire professional crews to do it in 1938, 1939, which again is in that book, From Valley to Quabbin. The front cover picture, you can see the Enfield Town Hall is still sitting there in the spring of 1939, and there's a crawler or whatever that's used to push logs around. And this is about the only building left standing in the village was that old town hall. So some people think, well, you know, if you go over there in a fishing boat, you can hook your line on a church steeple and ring a bell. No. This is a drinking water reservoir. You do not leave buildings in it to rot. Just like they cut all the trees down, stumps still float to the surface and go to the shoreline at times. You can still see them if you walk along the shoreline of the reservoir. But anything that was tall, you've got roads, stone walls, boundaries of grave areas, things like that, but there's no houses, no Atlantis that you can't go skin diving there anyway, so you're not missing anything as far as that goes. If you want to see what it was like, look at the documentary Under Quabbin, which came out about a dozen years ago. And those people got special permission to go diving in there. They even went over the heads of the people at the Quabbin. They went to the Boston office to get permission to dive in there. So that's not something you can do any day of the week. So it's a tragic place, but it's a special place. It's a place people go contemplate. They look at wildlife. Some people fish. They have a limited deer hunting season to keep the deer population down. But it's not a recreation area. You can hike there, you can bicycle there, things like that. There's a Quabbin Watershed Advisory Council, which is made up of a number of different groups. I'm a member of two or three of them, so I'm an alternate from one of them on that group, which advises on the policies and things there, access, recreation, things like that. And they have meetings four or five times a year down there at the Visitor Center. And the Visitor Center itself is something that came, the idea came from Les Campbell, the noted photographer from Belchertown. And that's been around now. It's going to be celebrating its 30th year pretty soon. And that's great, because people who go to the Quabbin, if they go to the Visitor Center, they'll know what it's about, at least get an idea about it. And the Swift River Valley Historical Society, which I was on the board of directors of that in the early 80s, that's the Historical Society. You notice they didn't call it the Quabbin Historical Society. They didn't want to memorialize the reservoir. They want to memorialize the valley. And that's what they do. They have several buildings there, including things like the old Dana fire truck, school bells and desks and furniture and genealogy, all kinds of stuff. So that's the place you want to go if you want to do some research on the history of the Quabbin. Although there are other places, the Athol Library, the Ware Library, this library right here have good newspaper files with resources about the reservoir. But basically, I'll go briefly over the process of what happened here. You have Boston, which is on the ocean. Of course, you can't drink salt water. The Charles and the Mystic Rivers flow into the harbor, but they got built up and polluted very early on. So in 1795, Boston went to Roxbury, which was then a separate town, and took over Jamaica Pond. And they built a hollowed-out log aqueduct to get that water into what was then the center of Boston. Now, the way they found out there were tons of leaks in the system back in the 1970s, some people think they were still using those hollowed-out logs, but that's not the case. They replaced them in the 1800s. But so from that little start, they went out to the Natick and took over Long Pond in the 1840s and made Lake Cochituate, made a reservoir out of that, which was used until the 1920s. And then they went to the Sudbury River in the Marlborough-Framingham area, and they took water out of several reservoirs along that in the 1880s. And then in 1895, they started what became the Wachusett Reservoir, which is north of Worcester. Routes 12, 110, 140 go along it or across it or whatever. And they thought that was going to last for quite a while, but a year after it was filled, which was 1908, in 1909 they were making surveys in the Swift River Valley, because that had been mentioned in the 1895 proposal for Wachusett as the next stop. So Metropolitan Boston has always seen the rest of the state as this thing they can reach their octopus out and grab things from. So we're the guinea pigs on that, I guess, out here. And then starting seriously in 1919, when they came up with a study commission, in 1922 they recommended what became the Quabbin Reservoir. They also thought they should divert water from the Ware River in Barrie and from the Millers River above my hometown of Athol. But the Millers River then was already kind of polluted from all the industries on it, so they dropped that one out. But they did take water out of the Ware River, which they still do, and flooded the Swift River Valley by creating the two dams for Quabbin Reservoir, and that was completed and filled in 1946. So it took them 7 years to fill it. It's 38.5 square miles of water, about 25,000 acres, and there's another 55,000 acres of watershed land they bought around it to protect it. So that's in New Salem, Shrewsbury, Petersham, and those other towns. So that's a brief history of how it happened, but there were several towns that were destroyed and villages, parts of seven other towns. I've just got a few photographs here I brought along. This is a shot of the Windsor Dam under construction. It was a hydraulic fill dam. Basically, water with certain types of fill was washed over the site, and then the fill settled, the water drained off, and that's how they built the dam. On the other side here, we have, this is the aqueduct, which is 25 miles long between the eastern shore of the Quabbin and what is now Hardwick, runs under the Ware River in Barrie over to the Quinnipiaxet River on the western edge of the Wachusett Reservoir. So that's how the water, this is under construction, it was later concrete filled. So we'll pass those around. Now, the four towns that were taken, one of them, Dana, was in my home county of Worcester County. We're not officially proud of the Happy Valley here, but we are in the Millers River watershed, so it does flow into the Connecticut River. So I think the Valley Advocate actually goes up as far as Athol, and they drop it off for people to read. So Dana, two major parts. Dana Common, the site of which is still above the water, and you can hike to it. And I've got a lot about that in my book, Historic Quabbin Hikes, including a lot of pictures of the buildings. Here's the north side of the common, the old town hall, the eighth grade school, a house, and a hotel. And this is the south side of the common. We have a house which has a very nice cellar hole, and I actually hid inside the root cellar one time when I got caught in a thunderstorm out there. The old Congregational Church, the Vaughn House, which had a beautiful pebbled stone wall around it, which you can still see, even though the house is gone, the Johnson Mansion, and the store. And if you look in the lower right of this picture, there is a dog there. You can't bring your dog into the reservation now, but this dog didn't know about any reservoir. The next town to the south was Greenwich. In Connecticut and England and New York, they all say Greenwich. These people said Greenwich, so that's how I pronounce it. So I can tell a true Quabbin fan from a Tyro, but yeah, I'm there in Greenwich. No, sorry, go back to New York. This is their war memorial, which is now at the Swift River Valley Historical Society. And you can see one of the mountains in the background, which is now an island in the reservoir. And here we are again, same thing, Mount Pomeroy, an island in the reservoir. And that's the site of Greenwich Plains, very flat. So the reservoir is like way above the old church steeple. So you can see the island, but the hill, but that's it. And then the town in the northwest, a lot of it is still above the water because it's on a peninsula that separates the two major arms of the reservoir. So it's called the Prescott Peninsula after the town of Prescott. Now this was the poorest of the four towns. They never had a highway department really, or a fire department, or paved roads, or hardly even telephone service or anything, which most of the other towns had some of. It's a real hill town. And it was the least populated, and a lot of the people moved out the first couple years after the reservoir project was passed. They didn't want to hang around and get caught out in the middle of nowhere. So we have a shot of North Prescott here. Now this building, the old store post office, is gone. The church was moved to Orange in 1949 by the then Prescott Historical Society. In 1985, that group disbanded and the building was moved down to the Swift River Valley Historical Society complex. Their main offices are in the basement and they use the church hall as their meeting hall. Now there's a fence across the northern end of the Prescott Peninsula. Well, that's there so people will leave the wildlife alone. Well, that's the reason they give you now. But it was built for a violent reason. It was built during World War II because they used the Prescott Peninsula and parts of the filling reservoir as bombing practice out of Westover Air Force Base. And then after the war, they said, well, let's leave the fence up and call it a wildlife sanctuary. So that's one major part of the Quabbin watershed you cannot walk into, the Prescott Peninsula. There are breaks in the fence, and I know where they are, but I'm not going to tell you. That is the parsonage of the church, and that's still standing, and that's still a house right there. So this is right at the edge of the Quabbin land takings, the so-called village of North Prescott, partly in New Salem, partly in Prescott. The cemetery out of the picture to the right is still there with its New Salem and Prescott graves. Now, this is a shot. The woman whose head is visible in the window, I interviewed her. She was a teacher, Annis LaPlante. She passed away over 20 years ago. She was in her 90s. And she told me this one-room school, they never locked the doors. Nobody was breaking in and tagging or doing any foolish stuff like they do now in those days. Big wood pile there. If some kid was naughty during the day, that kid had to come early, take some wood off that pile and stoke up the wood stove to get the place warmed up. If nobody was naughty, they drew straws. Whoever got the short straw had to come in and do it. Some of the kids walked the better part of 2 miles to get to the school. No high schools in any of the valley towns. You had to go to outside areas like New Salem Academy, Barry High School, Athol High School, or whatever to go to high school. So we'll pass that one around. And the largest of the four towns and the wealthiest was Enfield. Nothing to do with Enfield, Connecticut. It was named for an early industrialist named Robert Field when it was incorporated in 1816. Mount Ram, which is visible above the reservoir, was its most notable feature. Had about 1,000 people during most of its existence. A lot of factories making wood and wool products and such. The railroad, which connected Athol and Springfield through the valley from the early 1870s to 1935, was called the Athol and Enfield. And because this was one of the towns that helped fund it. So there's a lot of stuff going on in this picture. You can see the Chandler Mansion, which was one of the first buildings sold to the state, and they used it as their headquarters until the reservoir was getting up to flood it. the Methodist Church, the Congregational Church, which was referred to in a poem, which did burn in 1936, just as it was going to have its 150th anniversary. They never found out who did it. And running up the hillside behind it is a cemetery. The graves are gone, but the terraces are still there. And you can see a couple of the factories in the village and such. This is the main drag in Enfield on a nice day. You can see the Civil War monument now at Quabbin Park Cemetery, the Congregational Church, the roofless bandstand, the 8th grade school, and the only brick town hall in the valley, which the farewell ball was held in 1938 at that spot. So we'll send those around. You get to see a little bit about the towns and know a little bit about what they were like. I interviewed a lot of people who lived in that valley over the years and still do interview one or two people here and there. Again, as was alluded to in the poem, the younger people was, oh, wow, we can get out of this dull place and move up to exciting places like Athol or Orange or Ware or Palmer. Not too many of them went to Amherst or NoHo. Couldn't afford probably to move here for one thing, but if they were factory people, they went to places like Athol and Orange and Ware and Palmer because there were factory jobs in those places. If they were farmers, they might have bought a place in Shutesbury or New Braintree on the other side of the reservoir or Barry where they were farms. So that they could continue doing that. Some people went back and watched the reservoir being filled or went back to see it afterwards. Some people never did want, they didn't want to go back. They wanted to remember it the way it was when they left it, the valley, especially the ones who left early before much of any of it was destroyed. So again, there's a human tragedy involved here. And yes, it's a beautiful place. Yes, we have eagles and people bike and bicycle and hike and fish and do a little hunting and all that. But think of all these people, 2,500 people lost their homes and livelihoods and all that. And even the younger ones, they didn't mind leaving at the time. And then when they got older and they wanted to show their children and grandchildren where they grew up, nope, nothing there, folks. Sorry, it's all gone. Just a big hunk of water and a lot of trees and stone walls and things. I've seen people cry for a long time if they actually went back to the site of their cellar hole and saw what their property looked like. Now there's just a kind of a desolate looking wilderness. So this is the thing is, I want to stress to people that there's a very big human tragedy behind this, as there is with anything like this, or a war, or something like that. If they put a highway through your town, and you could actually move your house a few hundred feet down the street, your kids can go to the same schools, you can use the same library, and stop at the same stores, go to the same church, all that. When the whole valley's wiped out, this is different. This is complete change for you. Maybe you'll end up shopping in the same town you used to shop in, Athol or Ware, whatever, but that's about it. Everything else is totally different, and you're not going to be able to do anything that that you're used to do with people you were used to doing it with. So I think that's an important function for people to know, and I always stress that point, is it was not some happy, gentle, wonderful process that created eagles in the state. It was a nasty thing, and there were people that were shysters in some of the contracts and made money where they shouldn't have, and some people were able to get more property. One fellow told me that he, his brothers and sisters and his grandmother lived on a farm when what is now the Prescott Peninsula, and they knew they were dirt poor people. All they had was the farm, a couple cows and a horse, and they offered him $1,500 for the property, and the woman said, no, I'm not going to take that, that's nothing. The guy says, all right, comes back a week later, she says, well, what are you offering me now? He says, $1,400. So she said, I guess I got to take it. They're going to keep dropping it every time they come back. So she took it and moved to Warren. But put their cows on a borrowed milk truck, by the way, to truck them down to Warren. So you can see this was a very trying and difficult process for these people. So that the beautiful reservoir that the people mostly in metropolitan Boston enjoy drinking today, and the people around here enjoy, you know, walking, hiking, and bicycling, and whatevering in, has a sad story behind it. And obviously we can't obsess over it, but it's nice to remember it. And I think that's an important thing. So do I have a few more minutes, or am I running down to the, okay. There's a quote I'm trying to find here that I just thought of that I should have earmarked in the book, which I quote a lot of different sources, newspaper sources, interviews, whatever, regarding what happened to different people and the process of removing everything, burning, bulldozing, and all that. But I think um, I'm trying to find this because it kind of evokes a little bit of what the thing is like. Okay, this news correspondent went to Enfield the day after the farewell ball, which was held on April 27, 1938. That's at midnight, the four towns were disincorporated, which is unique in Massachusetts history. They were absorbed by adjoining towns. That's why if you look at a map, Petersham and New Salem look like big daggers sticking down toward Ware and Belchertown, because they took over a lot of the land from the other towns, and also some of the other ones did too. You know, the first people he saw in town were three men working in the cemetery behind the Grange Hall in Enfield. Comparatively few gravestones remain, as most of the graves have already been removed. The three men, dressed in overalls and straw hats, were filling in a grave that they had just removed the body from. Near them were four pine boxes already nailed up with the bones of a family of four, dead since the early 1800s. On the lids were marked the names in red pencil. Of the three men, one was perhaps in his late 20s, another was middle-aged, and a third was an old man. All three had lived in Enfield all their lives, but the middle-aged man had moved out 8 years ago. It was to him that your correspondent addressed the question, how do people in the valley feel about this? He answered, taking his time and glancing at the other two, words wouldn't express it. I would like to tell you what my opinion is, but it wouldn't sound good in print. After a long pause, he said, his voice very calm and even toned, they wouldn't move again. They got fooled once, but not a second time. They would have to send the army to get us out another time. The young man said, you bet your sweet life, and the old man grunted in approval. Then after he had spaded in a lot more dirt, visitors aren't welcomed much in this cemetery. People hereabouts don't like to have the cemetery looked at while it's being dug up and everything. Taking this as an indirect invitation to leave, your correspondent moved down the hill, noting on the way a large vault, burial vault, that had been built into the side of the slope. The front had been broken open as though a shell had hit it, with bricks and plaster littering the entrance. The heavy wooden door hung wide open. Okay, so this is something where they hired locals to do the grave digging. And obviously this reporter didn't get quite the reaction he was expecting from them, but they told him what they felt, and that's kind of, I tend to reflect that, and that's how I feel about it. I don't look at it as some fantastic, wonderful thing. You can't reverse it, you can't pull the plug on it and bring it back, but damn it, those people deserve at least some recognition of the sacrifice they made for this reservoir to happen. I'll just close and say that I have my books. They're at Broadside here in town. I think they're at Odyssey, and they're at Atkins and Hastings over in Amherst, so there's plenty of places you can get them if you don't want to do that tonight. And by the way, even though I am the vice chairman of the Coolidge Advisory Board and I've done three books on Calvin Coolidge, I am a registered Democrat, so hopefully you're and even the chairman of my town committee in AFL, so how's that? But I think Coolidge is a fascinating subject. He really is. The people just think, he never said anything. Well, he did more press conferences than any president before Franklin Roosevelt, so in his term, so that's just one thing. And by the way, he was governor of Massachusetts when the project of the Quabbin was first proposed. And he was president while it began, but he didn't really have anything to do with it. But that's what got me interested in Coolidge, was my Quabbin stuff and finding out that he was governor when that got started. So if you're looking for the degree of separation there, by the way, I will throw out one more little story. You've probably heard of James Joyce, the famous author. Well, there's a Quabbin connection. When his book Ulysses, they were trying to publish it in the United States in the early 30s. Of course, it was considered obscene in those days. And they brought it before a court to try to get it, you know, liberated to be published. And the judge was a man named John Woolsey in New York City. Now, he had a summer home in Petersham, and some of his descendants still live there. Judge Woolsey purchased the Prescott Town Hall in the late 1920s, and he had the building moved onto his property in Petersham and rebuilt there, and it's one of the most intact original Quabbin buildings. The whole town hall would fit inside this room easily, by the way, including the roof. Very small building. And sometimes he had hearings on court cases while he was out on his summer vacations in Petersham, and I believe one of them was for this Ulysses case, and he did decide that the book was literature and not obscene, so it could be printed in this country. So there's your degree of separation between James Joyce and the Quabbin. I'll leave you with that thought, and we'll take the questions after she comes back up. Thank you.
So if folks have questions or comments, responses, the speakers are happy to take. I've got, oh, yeah, Heather.
I was wondering if there is a predicted expiration date on how long the water would last in Quabbin, and if so, where would the tentacles reach next as their next source of water?
Originally, it was 1970. That was the original date they predicted, 1970. They're using a lot less water now, partly because of high water rates in the Boston area, and also the conservation mentality. People are putting in the special toilets, and the industries are recycling water more and all that. So they actually are down about 30-something percent from their peak usage in the late 70s at this point. They're actually looking actively to add more cities and towns in the metro Boston area to the water system so they can get more money to help pay for what they've already done.
Anybody else? Yes.
So I'm working on the Shays Rebellion, which is another time Boston thought they could turn to the people of Western Mass and treat them kind of like a cash machine. But that's 1786, and I just wonder, I mean, that Shays lived in Pelham's house is now in the Quabbin protected area, so you have to get special permission to go down to it. But I just wonder if you guys could talk any about the early history of the towns and what it was like when they were founded.
I don't have that information at this time, but I did, this was probably about 20, 25 years ago, I did a history of Shutesbury book, and a lot of, there's material in there about the Shays Rebellion. Yeah, and definitely some descendants that you might be interested in talking to.
I published a book written by another author about the rebellion in 1986, which was anticipating the bicentennial of the rebellion. Shays himself lived in the part of Pelham that later became Prescott. So his cellar hole, which was a cellar hole even at the time the reservoir came in, is on the peninsula there. He ended up fleeing through Vermont to New York State, where he died in the 1820s, and he befriended a young lawyer named Millard Fillmore, who remembered him in his old age after he became president. A lot of people from the valley, particularly Greenwich, which was the only one of the four towns to actually be a separate town at that time, participated in it. And some of them were pardoned in the process after the rebellion was over. Some of them, Shays and some of his fellow conspirators, met in the old Conkey's Tavern, which was in the Bobbin Hollow village on the later Prescott-Pelham line, now under the West Branch of the reservoir. So some people do like to draw that parallel between the Shays Rebellion and then the intrastate colonialism of Boston taking over the valley for the Quabbin. Shays wasn't the only one. There were many rebel leaders scattered around Western Mass, out as far as Stockbridge, West Springfield, whatever, but somehow his name got stuck with it.
I wanted to ask Gail about, you were thinking about bringing a song tonight. Do you want to tell us what the song was and who wrote it?
Oh, yes, if you're interested, there's a wonderful local singer-songwriter writer named Mark Arelli, and he has an album out, Signature Sounds. And I have the CD with me. I was going to play it as we ended, but we kind of didn't get our technology together. But there is a great song on that album called The Farewell Ball, and it references that last dance and the clock striking midnight and the town's becoming disincorporated at that moment, and it's a really haunting piece of music. And I just feel that there are a lot of artists and writers and musicians and storytellers and, you know, just plain folk who have incredible stories to tell, and especially if you happen to know many elders in the region and go to senior centers and start asking some questions, you'll get some very interesting stories and as J.R. said, tragic, and people still feel it as if it were happening now. There hasn't been much healing around this time, and I think it gets exacerbated by the generational, as you were referring, can't talk to your grandchildren, can't take your great-grandchildren there. And so that's when I invited folks to come to my class and they brought their scrapbooks. The teenagers just could not grasp that notion, mm-hmm. that these things were gone. And their first response was, well, why didn't you fight back? If that was me, I would have fought back. And it's that youthful feeling that there is something that someone can do, but the amount of you know, that land was really marked. The poverty was there, and it was not seen as that there was anything of value to be saved. So,
I'd like to kind of take off, if I may, on it just a little bit. People weren't chaining themselves to the gates of the project like they do at nuclear plants nowadays. They weren't holding signs and protesting. People didn't do this stuff. This was when Calvin Coolidge was president. Okay, you know, they had hearings in the Valley and Boston and places in between, and people said, the main thing is that, look, okay, you know, this has been hung in the legislature for quite a few years, as I recount in my Creation of Quabbin book. Like Rome, it wasn't built in a day. And people went to hearings and said, look, can you guys decide, or blank, or get off the pot, you know, are you going to do this or not? We want to know if we go on with our lives, or are we going to rip up and go somewhere else? And you didn't have, these people couldn't afford any dream team of lawyers or anything like that to go to bat for them. They had their local town lawyer councils and say, well, you know, we just want fair property provisions. The laugh is, they didn't really get that, and not only that, but the people who had worked in the valley that was taken for Wachusett Reservoir, several dozens of them got employment loss payments, whereas none of that was ever done for the Quabbin, which was much larger and affected a lot more people. So that's, again, my point, they got screwed, is kind of reinforced by things like that. Boston doesn't care much about this part of the state. And even with Stan Rosenberg becoming the next president of the Senate, we will find maybe he'll bring a few more crumbs out here, but there's still probably going to be crumbs.
Did you bring some information from the Watershed Council? Were those flyers yours? There were event flyers on the table. Was that from you?
No, my flyers are over there. Somebody handed out a flyer about logging. There's a few over there. That's a very strongly misunderstood issue. There's a man who came out here from Washington State who's been propagating all kinds of stuff. They spent about 2.5 years reviewing the logging setup and system at the reservoir. By the way, a lot of the pine stands and things like that you see at the Quabbin are not natural. They were planted after the reservoir was begun in the 40s. In the 40s, the pine was considered a wonderful watershed tree. Now we know it's one of the worst because they don't release water. They grow in large stands and get real tall, and a storm blows them down, and they're just no good. So they've been trying to extirpate a lot of these unnatural pine stands and some other trees over the years. Due to this recent study, they're cut down to the point where they're only going to be doing smaller cuts. So, you know, maybe out in Washington State, they cut 500, 800, 1,000 acres in one big swath. They've never done that here. Even at the peak, they might need 20 or 30 acres at the most. And now they're only doing, I think they're going to try to keep it under like 5 acres and do like crosshatch cuttings and things like that. So it's not, you can't do woodsman spare that tree there. It's a watershed. You need a mixture of fields and old growth and young growth and whatever to, and not only for the wildlife too, it's not just the water. Again, there are people who like to log the hell out of it so they can make tons of money off the logging, and there are people who don't want any logging at all because they feel that's right. And as often as the case with these political issues, I kind of find myself in the middle. So that's what I can tell you for a perspective on that. So somebody once said, if it's your information, it's propaganda. If it's somebody else's, it's propaganda.
Yeah.
Are there any other states that have demolished towns for similar purposes?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Ashokan Reservoir in upstate New York, Kingston, New York. Situate Reservoir in Rhode Island for Providence. They didn't take any whole towns, but there's several villages. Route 6 goes right through the middle of it. It was Route 6. In the Northeast, this one's kind of big. Quabbin. It's happened in a lot of places. Whole towns and stuff. And a lot of times you'll see it's somewhere like New York, some way up in the Adirondacks, they take a village and that's it. Or Barkhamsted in Connecticut, they took a few farms and hamlets, but no whole towns. But this one took 4 whole towns and parts of 7 others. So this is a big one for Southern New England. It's the biggest body of water in Southern New England.
Gail located something really interesting, which was a list of literature about drowned towns, including many novels and nonfiction books. We linked to it on the Facebook page about this event, if anybody is interested in that other those other situations. There was another question. Oh, Nyla.
I have a question for Gail. I'm wondering, you mentioned all the different forms of art that have been created about this event. What do you feel you gained from looking at it through the lens of poetry?
Well, I think what I gained very much so is that idea that it is not a simple equation, as we were talking about. What is lost, you know, and what is gained, trying to equate those is very complex. And what I gained was, I mean, what I was looking for as a writer is, you know, I wasn't writing a historical volume. I wanted to make sure that I put my voice in there so I could understand how it affected me. And what I gained then, I think, was a greater understanding of perhaps my own history, my own grandparents, and how they felt as immigrants, not ever being able to go back to their home country, not ever being able to recognize the village they came from, never seeing it again, not having any photos because they were poor. And so that, you know, that gave me an understanding then, or a little bit of an understanding of what it must have been like for the families that I met.
I would just point out that I've read a lot of fiction, including former Governor Wells wrote a novel about what he thought a teenage boy would have been like in the Quabbin that was being built. We won't get into that any further. It's called Stillwater if you want to read it. And I think she has done a very good job of expressing, you know, not only from her own point of view, but also reflecting a reality of the project and the valley and the people that it affected. Because there are some people that they want to project their own thing into something like this. And, well, that's a form of literature or creativity, whatever you want to call it, but I like accuracy. I like the real story. I want somebody to say, Mitt Romney came in and offered to buy all the property and save it for, no, that's foolish. But there are people who might take some kind of attack like that. And I think sticking to the exact theme, not necessarily the exact details, but the exact theme, is very important, and I think she did a very good job of that with her collection of poetry.
Well, thank you. I feel it was so important to honor the stories and the lives that were lived there, and I was very nervous when this book first came out because I did a lot of readings in the towns, and also a lot of the survivors came, a lot of people that I'd interviewed came, and I was like, oh, yeah, that's kind of really scary, like, oh, did I get it right? And it felt so great because a number of people really said, you know, I always look for things about the Quabbin. I always read whatever I can about the Quabbin. And I remember a woman coming up to me at the end and saying, this is the first thing that got it right. So, you know, if poetry, you know, but poetry is not the news, right? As the quote goes, men die miserably every day for lack of what is found there. Can't get it from the news, but maybe you can get it from poetry, and it's just another angle to explore history. Yeah.
Another question.
Yeah, there's two more, I think.
I wondered if you recorded your interviews with these survivors.
No, I didn't record. I wrote. We chatted and spent time together, and over time. So some of these stories took time to come out, like as they trusted me after we, you know, would meet together many times. It wasn't just a one-time thing.
I did the same thing when I took notes because I tried a tape recorder and somebody said, if you shut that damn thing off, I'll tell you a lot more stuff. I said, all right, I took notes. If you're interested in hearing the voices of Valley people, the Swift River Valley Historical Society has a lot of stuff that people did in the 60s and 70s and 80s taped interviews. I don't think they let too many of them out particularly, but you can go there and listen to some. And the Friends of Quabbin did issue a cassette. I think now they have a DVD called Here Was Home, which has snippets of interviews of people. And they also have a lot of the stuff now archived and even indexed on CDs and stuff. So the visitor center to Quabbin, you can go down and do that. The people are diminishing rapidly. If you were old enough to really remember what was going on there now, you're well into your 80s. And of course, not everybody at that age is fully cognizant of remembering things anymore.